All right, here we are, episode 50 of Merriwether's World. Hard to believe. I have now been on the air longer than some really bad sitcoms. So pretty cool. Thank you for joining me tonight. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Dr. Mark Merriwether Vorderbruggen, author of Idiot's Guide Foraging, creator of the Foraging Texas website, co-creator of the Wazoo Survival Bandana of Foraging and Health, and lots of other stuff too. Just a reminder, if I post anything from Amazon tonight, which I will be doing, I have to let you know that I get anywhere from 4 to 6% of the sales price, just as a thank you from Amazon. Pretty cool. Doesn't affect your thing. So tonight, Q&A, what I would like to do is try and keep it more focused on plants because I want to do a special prepper type show this Saturday. There'll be more information coming out. So probably this time Saturday, if you want more questions on coronavirus or prepping, shrimp for supper, you know, things like that, come join back Saturday evening. Like I said, tonight, let's focus on plants, though medicinal plants are probably a way of sneaking the whole medicinal plant stuff in there. All right. Do we have any questions? Otherwise, Wisconsin. Okay. Yeah. Narnia. Right now. Yeah. Okay. Even though I was saying we weren't going to cover medicinal plants, I have some really, 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 really amazingly good news. So let me just post that up. And it's not me. It's about John Slattery. He is a famous bioregional herbalist, which means he focuses on specifically the medicinal plants in the region around you rather than ordering stuff from Australia or Japan or something. But he is normally out on the Texas, like Arizona border, New Mexico border, way out there. But he will be in Dallas, Fort Worth area doing a two-day workshop, April 11th and 12th. So if you want to, you know, really get some good hands-on, I'm going to copy one more thing, some really good hands-on stuff, specifically Southwest Medicinal Plants. This is his book. I'm going to talk about this quick here, but I'm going to post a link. So, yeah, for those of you who want medicinal information on really the southwestern side of the state, he will be coming to here he is. So that's what he looks like. He's a cool dude. Back when I had the really horrible bicycle crash and ended up with all the cracked ribs and concussion and all that stuff, he sent me a bunch of herbs to help me through that time. So I'm truly indebted to this fellow. I will say the book Southwest Medicinal Plants, it just came out. I posted a link to that. Lots of good stuff. Stuff I didn't know, especially about some things like hackberry and a few other plants. So really, really good. Even though it's Southwest, he's located out, you know, like I said, at the New Mexico-Texas border area. A number of these plants are still around here. And just he also wrote Southwest Foraging. And these are plants that I marked that I still need to add to the Foraging Texas website. So really, really, really good forager, botanist dude. And like I said, he is coming to do a two-day medicinal plant making workshop up in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, April 11th and 12th. I wish I could get to it. It doesn't look like I can, though. So definitely someone you want to check out. Bunny, when am I going to be near Dallas? I don't know yet. I'm still trying to set that up with the Texas Survival School. Let's see. I like to freeze the flowers. I wonder, Matthew, are you talking about the hackberry flowers or some other flowers? Oh, borage. Ah, okay. I'm a little behind here because things go scrolling past. Yeah, borage flowers are really good in tea. Have kind of a cucumbery sort of flavor going on. Okay, so hit me with your questions. Otherwise, I'm just going to... Oh, I almost forgot. Of course, Herbs, the buddy over there. Let me put that up. So you get, if you use the Forking Weeds coupon code, you can get stuff from him cheaper. And of course, my long-term people, Uncommon Bees. And as usual, if you order something from Uncommon Bees between now and midnight, you get 20% off if you use the Forking Weeds coupon code. And I had a great call from Uncommon Bees this evening before the show. We've been working on a new infused honey, and he has successfully, or he'll know for sure tomorrow morning, but it looks like he's been able to make an echinacea infused honey. So very awesome there. It has 200 milligrams of freeze-dried powdered echinacea. To get the recommended dose for medicinal immune system stimulating properties, which the FDA does not claim or disclaim, but it takes 3 teaspoons a day of the new Uncommon Bees echinacea-infused honey to get what WebMD says is the proper dose of echinacea. So pretty cool there. Wait, that class is on Easter? When is Easter? As a Catholic, I should know these things. I hope it's not on Easter. Oh, wait. Oh, are we talking, John Slatterly's? Ooh, I don't know. I didn't even bother to look. Complicated. All right. Yes, Tina, I'm so in love with these little jars he uses. I'm assuming he's talking about these little jars. I keep ordering the CBD infused honey in that size just so I can collect the jars. You know what, Tina? I bet if you contacted him directly, he could set you up with those jars. Now, of course, sure, he'd much prefer to sell you the honey with the CBD or anything else in it. But, he's a cool dude. He'd probably do something like that. But definitely check out their thing. If not tonight, but probably tomorrow, they will have the echinacea-infused honey. They already have an absolutely fantastic elderberry-infused honey. But the echinacea, we thought that would just give people another option. And I knocked over the microphone. Yes. Oh, yeah, the echinacea on wounds. Well, honey is great on wounds, but putting something like the echinacea in there, or even the elderberry would help with that. Oh, Christy, would love to have you out to Mercer Botanic Garden. Can I email? Yes, go ahead, please. And let me just, in case you don't know, and I'm probably going to get a whole bunch of spam, but so be it. Foraging. Okay, so email me at merriweather@foragingtexas.com. Okay, scrolling. Kevin Marshall, my granddad, Indian Bones, told me about applying the backside of a thorn broken off of the toothache tree to dull the pain. True. Good for anything else. Excellent question, Kevin. And in fact, I talk about that over on Foraging Texas. Let me put up a link for you there. But the prickly ash, a.k.a. toothache tree, a.k.a. tickle tongue, actually has some really potent novocaine-like properties in it. It's one of the great things to do in my classes when we find one, to take off bits of bark and have people chew and then put it against their gum and suddenly... Then it goes away. So you have a fairly limited time. You have 5 minutes to yank the bad tooth out, at which point then you go and get a bottle of whiskey to slam it down. Where is up? Oh, there it is. Okay, so the I actually don't like using the thorns from it. I find the just the inner bark works really well. So you very carefully from the underside of a branch with a very sharp knife cut off a very thin slice of the inner bark. You want to get the outer bark and also the living cambium layer. So you want to get down to the full wood, but you only need a piece about the size of my thumbnail. And then you put it in your mouth, chew it up some, And then put it against the gum that right next to the tooth that's having the problem, and it will deaden those nerves for a short amount of time. You can also use leaves from the tree, especially in the young, basically from when the prickly ash toothache tree leaves just start coming out until about the 1st of July. Beyond the 1st of July, they are already starting to break down some, getting ready for fall. It is a deciduous tree, so it does lose its leaves. The other thing you can do with the prickly ash trees is take the berries, usually like the mid to late June, before they're completely ripe, and you want to crush them up and take the hulls of the seeds. So there'll be a clump of little seeds. There's pictures in the link I posted. I guess I can post it to everyone here too. So little tiny, it almost looks like elderberry, but a bunch of little berries on a stalk. You know, the berries are yay big, little tiny. I don't know if you can even see that. With a husk around a hard seed, crush them up. Take the seeds out if you can, but you don't have to get all of them up. There's no toxicity or anything like that. It's just the numbing effect in the husks is really good. And what you want to do is then mix that with some sort of hot sauce. Because if you've ever had the Szechuan sauce, it's what they call Szechuan peppercorns and hot peppers, where the Szechuan peppercorns change the flavor of the hot peppers into Szechuan-ness. And what that is the numbing agent in the husks of the prickly ash. These trees are found all over the world. The Szechuan peppercorn is just the husk of a prickly ash. Mix that with hot sauce and you make your own sort of Szechuan sauce. It's really good. You can take like a Louisiana hot sauce type thing, one of the, a ghost pepper or something like that, and make an East meets West sort of fusion Szechuan Louisiana type sauce. Really awesome. Okay. And of course, Matthew, I know in Minnesota they have the prickly ash, around where I grew up. I'm assuming in Wisconsin too. Okay, I need to scroll here. A quick word. When you are chewing the bark of the prickly ash or the leaves, it does not taste good. It really, the best way I've found to describe it is if you remember the old postage stamps that you had to lick to make stick to the envelope, it kind of tastes like those do. The husks of the seeds are much better, and they have almost a slight citrus sort of flavor to them. Okay, let's see, Easter is April 12th. Ooh, okay, well, I guess that will complicate things for John's class. I know, hey, Melanie, good to see you. Hey, William. Let's see, Great Spice. Okay, Andrew Herod, I just read an article about how unregulated the supplement market is. Is there a company you respect, particularly seal of approval, you personally look for? Okay, Andrew, you put me in a hard spot because I don't want to put a call out to my competitors because you may or may not know I have joined forces with a startup company to come out with a line of herbal supplements. So I'm going to table that particular answer for a bit. There are some good things. Okay, Consumer Labs. There's a website called Consumer Labs, and all they do is test herbal supplements. So one of the things our company will do is get our stuff tested by theirs to make sure, it's as good as we say it is. So, consumerlabs.org. Let me look. Hold on. Yeah, consumerlab.com. So, dietary supplements proven to be what they say. Okay. So, yeah, Andrew, just look down in the comments. I just posted a link to the Consumer Lab. So they're the company that we've picked to do the testing for our stuff, but they are a third-party independent. They have lots of reviews. Like Consumer Reports, they'll give you some teasers. They'll give you some free information, but you have to subscribe to them to get the full test results and everything like that. Because, yeah, Shauna, if you, she has a good point. Oh, you know what? Yes, let's just put one of those up. So one of the nice things about going to a local herbal shop and buying the stuff in bulk there is you can see the stuff. It's still in the plant form. So that's really handy. It's a lot harder to fake, you know, elderberry flowers than it is a white powder. So something to keep in mind there. So, yeah. Thank you, Shauna. That's an excellent. I'm going to give you a heart here. I'm going to try and give you a heart. Yes. Okay. Cool. All right. Mark Jen Lyle, do we have any medicinal mushrooms that grow wild here? I never have seen one. Oh, man. Or woman. Or person. Yes. We have a number of great ones. And I'm going to send you to the Foraging Texas website because if you scroll down, it has mushrooms there, and several in particular that are absolutely fantastic medicinal mushrooms. Of course, the first is the reishi. Around here, we have the Ganoderma sessile and the Ganoderma curtsy, two of the reishi family, amazing medicinal properties. We have turkey tail. Also really good for infections and cancer fighting and all sorts of amazing stuff like that. We have lion's mane, which is a proven neuroprotective type thing. The studies, lots of studies to show it's had some really great effects supporting proper brain functioning, especially in people who are starting to encounter situations where the brain isn't functioning as well. Let's see, those are the, oh, and of course the hoof mushrooms, very antibiotic. Psilocybin, which is some really interesting antidepressant type function. So yeah, we actually have a lot of medicinal mushrooms around in Texas. Like I said, go to the Foraging Texas website, scroll down on the left-hand side down to mushrooms, and just click on each of those. One thing on the Foraging Texas website I've been doing is adding all the medicinal properties of the plants. So not every plant has it. I focus the ones that are, you know, going to be in my book and common ones first, and then others that are really cool or things that I've linked to, things like that. So you can find a lot of medicinal plant information over on Foraging Texas. Hey, Sandra. Hey, Sam Kaufman. Oh, man. I hope you don't think I'm muscling in on your turf. So Sam Kaufman, if you don't know, the Human Path up in the San Antonio area, awesome, awesome, awesome herbal instructor, primitive skills instructor, all around cool dude. So definitely check him out. Let me pull up a Human Path to, whoops, and just post, oh, come on you. Yep. Me just, okay, so I just posted, whoop, did it go up? Oops, let me try this again. I mean, it's a lot more than just an herbal school. It has all sorts of other wilderness, primitive skills, first aid, all sorts of really cool stuff like that. Okay, there we go. Let's see. I'm going to scroll back. Tangerine skin, Consumer Labs. Okay. Renee Perry asks, how do you make something from mullein plant to help with upper respiratory? So let me post a link to mullein there, Terry. But it's really as simple as drying I like the leaves and the flowers. The root also has some properties, but dry it really well, crush it up, and make a tea out of it. Mullein. Oops. Let me just, sorry, I'm looking away. I feel kind of, oh, you actually put a link there. Okay, sorry. Yeah, so Renee, basically powder it, you know, dry it, let it dry, powder it, drink it as a tea. You can mix it with other teas. You can make your own chai tea out of it. Really, really, really good. Melanie, video seems to be lagging the chat a bit. I bet it's lagging when I'm going looking up other websites. So I think what I'm going to do moving forward, if I don't have the website already pre-opened, I will go back and post the answer to your link, or a link with the answer to your question there while answering it verbally here. So let me get to BJ Upchurch. His question, what would your choice of mixture be for the common cold? Okay, great one. Assuming you are older than 12 years old, and I know BJ, you are, my preferred mixture for colds is a mixture of goldenrod to deal with the stuffy, congestion, runny nose type stuff. So dried goldenrod, either the flower or the leaves, some willow bark, which I'd boil first with the tea just for the aspirin part. I believe the willow bark has some extra stuff in there that helps beyond what just a regular popping an aspirin pill does, though I don't have any proof for that. And then with the cold, elderberry for its antiviral stuff. I also grow heals all or self heal, which is good with some antiviral type properties. If I had access to some turkey tail mushrooms, which I don't right now, that helps fight viral, attack. So the turkey tail mushroom, antiviral properties, the reishi mushroom, antiviral properties. And if I was up in the hill country, I would be gathering all the fillery I can right now and use that, because fillery is a really potent antiviral. It actually triggers the interferon process in the cells to block the replication of invading viral DNA. So goldenrod, willow's bark, and some sort of antiviral such as reishi, turkey tail, or fillery, and then also elderberry to help with the immune system. Those do a pretty good job of it. I had a job interview back when I was unemployed, came down with a terrible cold, realized I need to knock this. And with a mixture like that, I had it gone in 2 days. It was amazing. Normally, it would last like 4 for me. I'm generally pretty healthy, but this one in 2 days, I was fine. And I wasn't going to the interview with, drainage and bloodshot eyes and all that. So, okay, Carrie, I found cleaver. What should I do with it other than eat it? Okay, Carrie, don't eat the cleaver. It's going to cling to your throat. What you need to do with the cleaver is you need to go and you need to chop it up really fine, green. Don't even bother drying it. Just chop it up real fine, green, and drop it in Everclear and let it make a tincture there that has some really potent I said I wasn't going to bring up a new website because it kind of causes the, but I wanted to make sure. Oh, I don't even have it on there yet. Okay. So the cleaver tincture that I was talking about, anti-cancer. So it's been shown to greatly reduce the chance of a person developing a cancer. I'm not sure what it does if you already have the cancer, but the ethanol extraction of cleaver, there are compounds that have been shown to help reduce the incidences of cancer. So then just take that and let it soak in the Everclear 6 to 8 weeks, strain out the plant material, and just take like a teaspoon every day. All right. Hey, Fry. Let's see. Okay, Jonathan. I once heard... Oh, boy. Okay, Jonathan. He says, I once heard that in order to test for toxic or problematic plants, one would rub the plant matter on the skin at first, then wait, then taste and spit, then wait, and then try a little weight, then eat a bunch. Is that accurate or bad advice? So what you are describing, Jonathan, is called the universal edibility test, and it is absolute unequivocal bullshit. Do not do it. It was taught to U.S. military members. They say, you know, rub some on your skin for a little bit, wait 24 hours to see if any blistering or anything occurs. If it doesn't, rub it on the inside of your lip and wait 24 hours and see if it happens. Most likely what you're going to do is end up poisoning yourself with some tasty, poisonous plant. That is very, very much a bad idea. The only time I would recommend that is if we are in like a Venezuelan situation where all the food is gone, you know, because the people voted to give all their food to each other and it ended poorly. So if there's absolutely no food available and no food expected to come, if the choice is death, you know, through starvation or food, then go ahead and try that. But the universal edibility test is just a bad, bad, bad way. There are a lot of plants that taste good that will just, you know, destroy your liver or otherwise cause really bad problems. So, yeah, don't do it. Yep, Matthew answered there too. Yes, Renee, Fillory. I was up there teaching this Sunday, and there was Fillory everywhere. Juniper berries and rocks. You don't, man. How do you feed your goats, Carrie? All right. Okay, Anna. How many cups cleaver to ethanol? So with that, do around a 50-50 mixture of cleavers to ethanol, to in particular cleavers to the Everclear. So for every cup of cleavers, a cup of the Everclear. All right, good to know. Okay, Chad, are you familiar with Beats for Energy as advertised? Great question. So those of you who might have been watching TV recently for some reason, rather than, you know, being outside, are starting to see beets being advertised as the latest superfood. There is some scientific background to that. One of the things that happens when you eat beets, is it triggers a natural increase in nitric oxide in your body. Nitric oxide then has several beneficial properties. One of them is that nitric oxide is the trigger molecule that the body produces to tell the immune system, hey, release the killer T white blood cells to destroy this infection that I've tagged. So it increases the rate at which the immune system starts producing and releasing the killer T white blood cells. So that's good. But it's also a relaxant for blood vessels. So it relaxes the blood vessels, allows them to become more flexible so they can deliver more blood. The blood, your heart, as it's pumping, it's sending blood through your vessels. And if your vessels are really rigid, only a certain amount of blood can get through there, and especially the blood pressure goes up. But if your blood vessels are kind of chill and they can kind of stretch out some, the end result is you can get more blood flowing through your body at a quicker rate, which means more oxygen delivered to the cells. So when you're, you know, running and working and all this and working out, the beets help deliver oxygen to your blood cells, kind of indirectly by relaxing the blood vessels. Now, there's a bunch of plants that do this. So it's not just beets that do that. Ginger, hawthorn, a number of them will do that. You know, if you're going to do it, go ahead and eat raw beets. You know, get the powdered beets if you want. So it will have some effect, but there's nothing I've seen, because I've been doing a lot of studying of herbal supplement type stuff, that puts it above some of the other herbs, you know, like hawthorn and rosella, hibiscus, that do the same thing. And with a higher concentration and a really known powerful effect. Okay, Cynthia, what is the best way to dry heels all? So cut the leaves, you know, take like a third of the leaves per plant if you're, you know, picking it from private property, hopefully you're growing it, and just lay them out on a screen somewhere in a cool, dry place and let them air dry for 2 weeks. This helps break down the cell wall. So when you put the heels all in, you know, if you're making a tea or a tincture or something like that, the cells now have escape routes for the chemicals inside the cells to get out. So let it air dry 2 weeks and then go ahead and seal it in an airtight container, or go ahead and make your tincture out of it, or even go ahead and powder it. And you can buy the little, you know, empty gelatin capsules on Amazon to make your own heels all herbal supplements. Okay. Jordan, would vinegar work as well for cleavers or anything besides alcohol? Good question, Jordan. Unfortunately, the scientific research that did these studies on the cleavers anti-cancer fighting, they actually did test a number of different solvents, and the ethanol, the Everclear, the pure ethanol, withdrew 50% more of the compounds than any other solvent they found. Now, what you can do is use the Everclear to extract the alcohol and then mix the Everclear with the vinegar, heat up the vinegar. Don't do this with vinegar, because you're also going to drive off the acetic acid. Go back, rewind. Okay, what you want to do is take the alcohol tincture you made with the cleavers, and instead of vinegar, use, you know, however much of the, well, actually, you don't want to use much. You want to make what's called a glycerin or a glycerate tincture, where you replace the alcohol with glycerin. You can buy food-grade pharmaceutical glycerin at drugstores. It's very similar to ethanol as far as dissolving power. The problem is it's also a good food for bacteria and microbes and things like that. So if you just put fresh plants in there, all sorts of nasty things will grow. Also, if you say you dried or somehow managed to sterilize your plants before putting them in the glycerin, you're still going to introduce bacteria from the air, and it's going to go bad quickly. So with your big bottle of Everclear tincture, cleaver tincture, you want to fill a little bottle with glycerin, well, half filled with raw glycerin, and then half filled with the Everclear tincture. Shake it up, heat it up, drive off the Everclear. You're going to be left with a small thing of, you know, the glycerin. And that, you know, you just make enough for a week's worth and store it in your refrigerator. You want to keep the glycerin, now the glycerin with the all the chemicals you extracted out of the ethanol, keep it in the refrigerator and get rid of it after a week. Because after a week, there's a very good chance that something bad is growing in it. So that's the, if you want to avoid ethanol, want to avoid consuming ethanol, that's really your only way of doing it if you want the cancer fighting properties. Yeah. Carrie. Yeah. So Everclear. Yep. Everclear. Okay. Oh, your wood sorrel froze last night. It will return. Okay. Dion, does the cleaver tisane have the anti-cancer effect? No. The particular molecules that you want are not very water soluble. so they won't be coming out of the cleavers into your water if you're trying to make just a regular tea or water to seine. So you really need to extract with ethanol first and then transfer the, you know, a small amount into something else to get rid of the ethanol. Hey, Cammie, but you're here. Okay, Renee, do you have to have clear alcohol for making a tincture? If you are making the cleaver tincture for anti-cancer properties, yes, you need the Everclear. If you're just making a standard tincture out of just about any other plant, once it is dried, once the plant is dried, then the regular 80% alcohol works great. That's normally what I use. Oops. So like in my elderflower in brandy, that was just an 80 proof type stuff. You need to have at least 80 proof to keep it shelf stable. If you drop below, you know, 80 proof is 40% ethanol. If you drop below that, you run the risk of things growing in it. Yeah, Sean is saying the higher the proof, the better when you're using fresh plant material, because it is going to dilute the Everclear down to the 40%. I like the dried stuff. I feel that's better. Jordan, are we talking like two beets, or would you have to eat a ton of beets for this event? Great question, Jordan. Here's what you do. Check your blood pressure. You know, hang out, you know, buy a beet, go to CVS where they don't sell beets, so they can't accuse you of shopping the beets. Take your blood pressure from the machine, eat the beet, check your blood pressure again. You know, explain to people around you what you're doing. Tell them that you learned this at Foraging Texas from Merriwether, and that they should tune in to these shows every Thursday. But see how many beets it takes to have an effect on your blood pressure, because the drop of the blood pressure is one of the signs. Ooh, another thing you could do is eat the beet and lay down and then quickly get to your feet. And if suddenly you faint and fall over, your blood pressure has dropped quite a bit. And so that's enough beet to get an effect. So, you know, something to try. Okay. BJ Upchurch, do you utilize yaupon holly other than boil the leaves? Such as no, I don't use the any other part of the yaupon holly other than the leaves, and just make the tea from the leaves for the wonderful antioxidants and wonderful taste and caffeine that it provides. Hey, Brother Paul. Brother Paul is here. Everyone go, ah, it's Brother Paul, my younger twin. Okay. Let's see. All right. Okay, Robin, what is the code word for bees discounts? The code word is forking weeds. Plural one. Let me just put it here again. One word. There you go. Everything you need to know to get the discount. Like I said, you normally the forking weeds code gets you a 10% discount from Uncommon Bees, but during the show and until midnight Thursday, you get 20% off, which is just an absolute steal, especially on some of the really expensive stuff like the CBD. Is this on there? Yeah, the CBD type stuff. Yeah, so, and, you know, support Uncommon Bees. Okay, whoops, what do we else got here? Carrie, would pickled beets have the same effect? I don't know. I would recommend taking some and testing your blood pressure and seeing what happens. It would be great. I love pickled beets. That was one of the things my mom used to make. We would can the pickled beets, and I absolutely loved them, even though, you know, they turned your teeth purple, you know, for a little bit. But yeah, give it a try. The scientific research was basically on, you know, raw beet extracted and seeing what happens. Shauna, five people just eating raw beets in the produce. I knowingly wink at each other. Yes. Okay. Oh, Carrie mentioned that the gluten wheat gave her high blood pressure, and getting rid of the gluten from her diet dropped it. So that's good to know. Kathleen, they can't arrest us all. No, but they can shoot us all. But we will return stronger, better, faster. Beet juice, carrots. Yeah, I'm not sure about beet juice. I would think beet juice, but again, it's worth trying. If any of you, my mom. Hey, Paul, brother Paul, use mom's home blood pressure test thing. This is your homework. You need to test your blood pressure there at grandma and grandpa's, at mom and dad's place. Eat a beet, test it. Eat another beet, test it. Weigh the beets beforehand and then report back to everyone next week. Okay? Cool. Thank you. Carrie just finished a pint of home canned pickled beets. Oh, so delicious. So good. All right. What else do we got? Holy moly. It's 8:15 already. All right. What other questions do we have? Just for those of you who tuned in, like I said, today I'm trying to focus on tonight's episode. I'm really trying to get back into the focusing on plant information. Though this Saturday, 8 to 9 p.m., I'm going to do another special edition for people that are interested in learning about, you know, prepping, basically being prepared for, you know, day-to-day disasters all the way up to the end of the world, some basic, you know, things to have in your kit and so forth. I've done two shows about this, but this again is something new. I've gained a lot of followers recently that probably haven't gone back and seen that. So 8 p.m. to 9 p.m., maybe a little longer, depends on, you know, what the family, you know, if they drag me away. But this Saturday, I'm going to do an intro to prepping type thing. Okay, yes, do it for the tribe, Paul. You must do this. Oh, yeah. Paul doesn't like beets. Okay, so have one of your sons do it. Have Micah do it. Ooh, Nick, question. What are your top three wild edible picks to cultivate in the backyard? Okay, I'm going to answer this question, Nick, as far as if I was trying to maximize the nutritional value of my backyard. So there are lots of great plants for like food reasons and drink reasons from a taste or, you know, pleasurable. But I'm going to look like, you know, the three, nutrition and medicine. I would plant in my backyard, if I could only have three wild edibles, definitely heals all for the medicinal properties. It has probably the best medicinal properties in the most compact form and grows really well here. Lamb's quarter, definitely lamb's quarter. The nice thing about lamb's quarter is it's extremely nutritious. It's considered to be a superfood. You can get lamb's quarter seeds online. You could plant them now, and they will still grow plenty big in time for the summer. And one of the nice things, besides being really, really, really nutritious, is you can freeze it or dry it to store it for later. And so you can grow lots of the lamb quarter to get lots of nutrition, loaded with vitamin A and vitamin C and lots of other good things. The third is a toughie. I'm mentally walking through my yard. I'm assuming by wild edibles, you're saying not a fig tree. I would go with wild onions. Another great source of vitamin C. And if done right, they can grow all year round and they just taste good. So that would be a big one. And you can grow lots in a small area. And you can grow them inside the house and outside the house. Onions have all sorts of health benefits. They help stimulate the immune system, help fight cancer, lots and lots and lots of good stuff, lots of good antioxidants, and they taste good. Now, you might have smelling a bit funny, but if I could only have three, definitely a lamb's ear with wild onion combo tastes really good. And you can make like onion soup. You can make salads, all sorts of things like that. So heals all for the medicinal properties, lamb's quarter for the superfood nutrition, and wild onions for different sorts of nutrients and other medicinal properties. Donut party at Paul's house. Voodoo donuts is 24 hours. No excuses, you all. Wade, any special guest or solo on Saturday's show? Right now, it's just solo. I wonder, maybe I can ask. Ooh, hey, Kenneth, if you're out there. Ooh, that could be a good one. Let me think on that. Because there's a number of people. I have some ideas. Let me talk to some people. Probably will be a solo because this is, you know, really short time. But there's some people that I'm going to ask. Okay, Renee, is there anything besides a tea that can be made with agarita leaves? I have lots and lots and lots of agarita leaves. Really, Renee, for the medicinal properties, agarita leaves, the tea is the best. The only other thing would be to dry them, pound them into a powder, and then put the powder in capsules and take it, the anti-nausea properties, as a capsule. Now, don't forget, the flowers can be used to make a good tea or to flavor the leaf tea. The berries are really good, and the roots are extremely medicinal with the high concentration of the berberine molecules. All right. Ooh, 8 minutes here. BJ Upchurch, thoughts on dandelions? My thoughts on dandelions, it should be illegal for people to kill dandelions in their yard unless they are going to eat them or use them as medicine. Absolutely fantastic medicinal plant. It was really a toss-up between the dandelion and the wild onion for the three wild plants for the backyard. But in the end, I decided the lamb's quarter will cover a lot of the nutritional value of the dandelion. It doesn't cover the medicinal, but between the heels all and the wild onion, you'll get a lot of the medicinal properties. But dandelion's absolutely wonderful, wonderful food. And one of the great things about them, those of you who take my class, you know this, the root of the dandelion can go down, you know, over 12 feet down into the soil. And if nothing else, when the dandelion dies, you now have 12 feet worth of organic matter infused into your soil, making your soil that much richer and healthier and more organic. Okay, Henry, where can you get vitamin D? Sunlight, 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 sunlight. By far, the best source of vitamin C is sunlight. Now, here's the other thing. Mushrooms. Fresh, raw mushrooms, if they're cooked or dried or anything like that, it's not going to work. But like the, you know, the little button mushrooms and stuff you get at the grocery store, put them in the sun. You know, just set them in the sun for several hours. Mushrooms produce melatonin. Mushrooms, from a whole physiological point of view, are closer to animals than they are to plants. But they've shown that putting mushrooms in sunlight causes them to produce the melatonin and vitamin D. Yay! So you can get vitamin D from mushrooms that have been put in the sun, which is pretty awesome. Okay. Kathleen, my onions are absolutely true to everything you've mentioned about them. Cool, cool, cool. If you're using dandelion flowers to make a tea or a jelly or a wine or anything, remember, you need to peel off the little green calyx from around the base. You just want the yellow petals. You don't want that green cup that holds the petals. That green cup is extremely bitter. Take it off there. Okay, 5 minutes. Dandelion greens are great in smoothies. Matthew, Isabel, dandelion greens are great in smoothies. I'm assuming you get them very young. Do you put anything in there to help deal with the bitterness? Or do you kind of dilute it with a bunch of other stuff so you don't get much more than a hint of the bitterness? I'm curious on that. Yeah, Sandra Buck. Yeah. Put your mushrooms in the sunlight for a while before eating them, and they become much more nutritious. Kiri, vitamin D, mushrooms, D2 or D3? I don't remember off the top of my head. I know I could claim one and have a 50-50 chance of getting right, but I don't remember. Yeah, I thought you recommended always cooking mushrooms. So there is a toss-up there. One of the nice things about the store-bought mushrooms is most people don't get an upset stomach from them if you eat them raw. But you do want to cook it. But, you know, this is one of those things where cook fast, at, you know, quick at high heat, because the breakdown of the chemicals, especially like vitamin C, which there isn't a lot in mushrooms. I'm not sure about the heat stability of vitamin D, but I suspect it's not great. So just quick fire and then pop them in your mouth. That's why still going out and getting sunlight is still by far the best source of vitamin D. You know, everyone is so scared of skin cancer and stuff right now. The amount of exposure you can get, you know, you meter it out kind of throughout the day, get the vitamin D. It's the health benefits of the vitamin D far outweigh the risks of cancer. Oh, okay, you blanch your dandelion grains. Okay, yeah, that'll take care of a lot of the bitterness. Matthew, when you blanch them, does the water turn green, or do you do anything with the water from the blanching? I know it's just a quick dip, so it's probably not going to lose too much. But yeah, I'm curious on that. Renee Perry, is there somewhere to get the heels all plant? Okay, if you're in... Oh, I know different nurseries carry it. I know you can buy the seeds for it online. Renee, check with local nurseries and see if any of them carry it. Because of its medicinal properties and strong ability to grow in a lot of conditions and a very unique looking flower head, it's sold as an ornamental a lot, but also to people who are in the know. So start there, look online. You can definitely find seeds for heels all from a number of suppliers. I think even like Rose Mountain might sell it. I'm not positive, but look around. As far as the plant goes, right now it's just starting to come up, so it's going to be a while before the seeds are available. Okay, Matthew, you only dip it in there for 10 seconds. Cool. Oh, wait. Tina Marie. Yay, Tina Marie. She will trade the heels all Prunella vulgaris for El Garita. I know she's been looking for El Garita. So, Renee, talk to Tina Marie. Tina Marie, talk to Renee. Become friends. This is part of the tribe. You are all doing what the tribe is supposed to do, and that is share things. Awesomeness. Cool. Okay. thank you. Voice to text. Okay. thank you, Matthew. So Matthew just posted a link for including dandelions in your smoothies. Awesome. I never tried that, just because I suspected it was going to be bitter, but if they got some things in there, that take care of it. Ooh, yeah, blueberry, ginger. Cool. Okay. Whoa, 8:59. We have 1 minute left. Like I said, I'm going to do the usual now. I will go back and answer people's questions, you know, write in answers to them. So if I didn't get my answer, if you don't remember it, or if someone else wants to see the answer too later on, just go back, look for the question, scan through the question, and it's going to take me a few hours to get all the questions answered, but I'll take care of that tonight. Other than that, it's 9:00. Love you all. Thank you again for coming and hanging out with me for an hour. There's all sorts of other things you could be doing. I hear there's a thing called television that some people find quite entertaining, things like that. But for now, it is time for you all to, you know, go do something else now. All right. Love you all. Thanks for coming. Bye-bye.